We're going to go through some opening items. Mission of the school board is to, the mission of the school district is to ensure that all students achieve the highest intellectual and personal potential and are prepared to contribute as global citizens in the 21st century. The role of the board is to have the ultimate success of students in the Burlington School District require the participation and collaboration of many players, including the school board, superintendent, administrators, teachers, students, families, and caregivers, community members, faith communities, city officials, legislators, and voters. The school board has a unique role to play, empowered by the voters in our community to demonstrate leadership regarding equity and inclusion for our diverse student population. In addition to establishing policy for the district, the school board affirms and defines its role in the following ways. Create a vision for equity and inclusion. Monitor progress toward the vision. Engage the community. Advocate for the vision. And develop board capacity and effectiveness. I'd like everyone to stand for the Pledge of Allegiance. I have a roll call. Officer Barlow?
Here.
Lauren?
I'm here.
I just gave up going after your last name. Commissioner Cena?
Here.
Commissioner Curry?
Here.
Commissioner Dodson? Be back at 7:45. Commissioner Judson?
Here.
Commissioner Harrington?
Here.
Commissioner Kirk?
Here.
Commissioner Kleeman is out. Commissioner Seguino? Oh. Commissioner Stoll? Xander Long? Xander? And George Asik. Okay. We have one of the first board meetings that we're going to be trying our best to stay within timelines. So you might hear us calling it. We don't need to be rude if somebody's speaking. We just have to try to. We have a lot of things to try to get in at most of these things, and unfortunately, the only way that happens is when we go into the 11 or 11:30 at night, when there's a greater propensity to make bad decisions. So we're going to try to keep this down. So if we're going to have speakers timed, if anybody does want to speak, when we do get to that point, same thing with anybody that's scheduled for to talk about items from schools. Okay.
Start out with the students.
Yeah. I'd like to invite the STEM presentation by the Flynn students.
To introduce Mr. Mack and Ms. Asaro and students from Flynn.
Nicholas Mack. I'm a fourth grade teacher at Flynn.
I'm Courtney Acero. I'm the STEM teacher at Flynn Elementary.
Do you want to introduce yourselves by your first names?
I'm Maddie, and I go to Flynn. I'm in Mr. Mack's class.
I'm Abby. I go to Flynn, and I'm in Mr. Mack's class.
I'm Ella, and I'm in Flynn, and I'm in Mr. Mack's class.
My name is Aurora. I go to Flynn, and I'm in Mr. Mack's class.
So the way this project got started was there was a district course that was offered about getting iPads into the classroom. And Courtney and I started collaborating at that point. And so we came up with another project that we thought met some of the criteria from that class. So later on, we actually wrote a proposal to get into Dynamic Landscapes, which is one of the local tech festivals, kind of tech conferences that teachers get to go to, which is great. So, it all kind of started with this question. Can we create a conductive stylus? We have a fair amount of iPads in the classroom, and we're really interested in, can we make a stylus that interacts with the screen? It's a little bit more complicated than just using a piece of rubber to touch on the screen, because it's it needs to be conductive at this point. So that started thinking down the path of some of the technology standards, so some of the ISTE standards. And from there, we started incorporating NGSS standards and some math standards and some ELA Common Core math standards as well.
And what you'll see, also see evidence of today through At the end of their presentation is some new methods used in NGSS. I'm involved in an NGSX piloted facilitator pathway, and it basically is teaching all teachers the new way, pedagogy to teach science K through 12. So we've done a lot of that work through this, and you'll see it in modeling and talk rooms with them specifically.
So the questions on the left up here kind of illustrate the way we started as a class, and then from there, Maddie's going to kind of lead us through that next step.
We have a 3D printer in our classroom, and that's how we made our stylus. And our 3D printer works because there's a filament, and we put the filament through a tube, and the 3D printer melts the string, and it reforms the string into what you modeled on Tinkercad. And Tinkercad is a website for designing 3D printing designs, and helps you print your design onto the 3D printer. And we use Chromebooks to do Tinkercad, and on Tinkercad, my teacher made the original design, and we copied the design and imprinted our name into the stylists, and then we printed it.
So this kind of gets at some of the math content standards. So we're looking at how objects rotate in space. So they had to take their letters and rotate them. They also had to print, and this is an example of the software used to print right here. And you can see that there's a coordinate system on the right up there, and there's rotational axes on the left. And so students had to be familiar with using those, which match up with our standards.
First, we tested three different kinds of strings to see if it was conductive. We tested it by putting the string so it's touching the metal parts of the circuit. We needed light bulb, connectors, and batteries to make a complete circuit. Then, if the string was conductive, the light bulb will light up. Then, we threaded the conductive string through the stylus. I knew that the light bulb would light up because we used the conductive string. And I knew that the string was conductive because we tested it. The light bulb lit up. After we tested string, we tested tape. We tested three varieties of tape: masking tape and flashing tape, and scotch tape. We tested string to see if it was conductive. We wrapped masking tape around the conductive string. We tested it on an iPad. The masking tape wasn't conductive. Then we tested the scotch tape. The scotch tape wasn't conductive either. Then we tested the flashing tape. Then we put the sponge in the stylus. The sponge needs to be a little wet to work.
How my stylus works is when the sponge and the conductive string wraps around the sponge and the tape wraps around the conductive string that touches the iPad, but you're not done yet. If you don't touch or hold down the flashing tape, it will not work because you have energy in your body that you need for the stylus. That is what you will find. You have to hold down the tape again, then touch your armpit. And then you have your own stylus. But we figured out that in our next STEM class that the sponge was dry, so it did not work. We all talked about it and came up with one idea. The sponge was dry, so we thought about it, and we figured out you need to have moisture in the sponge to work. After we figured that out, we all sat in a circle and talked about it for a long time. We all agreed how a stylus works. We also figured out that water is conductive, so you need the moisture in the sponge to work. We also talked about that for a long time.
Thank you all really very much. It was a great presentation, and I just have a question. Did you start with a hypothesis, or did you just do the experiment and then talk about what you saw and learned?
Use the word prediction.
Oh, what?
Prediction.
Oh, sorry.
That's okay.
No, they're really.
So, did you have a prediction before you started?
No, not really.
What was that?
No, not really.
So I just want to tell you that that's really different than the way I learned science. And what I really like about your way of doing it is that you set it up and observed it and then talked about what you learned from it instead of starting with some assumption, trying to prove whether that was wrong and or right. And I think that your way of doing it works better.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I do have to step backwards for a second. Thank you, kids. You guys are all set on me. Back to the approval of the agenda. I believe we have a couple of changes to propose on the agenda. Commissioner Cina?
Yeah, I'd like to make a motion to add to the agenda a 10-minute presentation on the Partnership for Change.
This would be number 3.1 immediately following this motion, as a matter of fact. Any discussion? All those in favor say aye. Any against? No. I also have one other proposal for a change in the agenda, which would be number 6D, which is adding a discussion that we'll have on the dates for the board retreat in July.
That's already on.
I know the joint retreat with Winooski's on.
It's on its A.
Do it with that?
No, that's the joint retreat with
Winooski's. Oh, my bad.
One more person says that. One more.
It's on there as A.
Can we do it at the same time?
It's going to be within the board report, so it's just going to be another item. It's going to be D. So we just need to get dates. Any discussion? All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Any against? No. Thank you very much.
I'd just like to ask that we remove the consent agenda for discussion.
Okay. Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
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 Any against? Thank you. Okay, we're going to move right on to the presentation by the Partnership for Change.
So today for our partnership update, we have Xander Long, who's also a student school board member. And Xander is going to present on a recent trip that he took to another school district to learn about work that they're doing with student engagement and student voice. Am I correct?
Yep.
Okay.
I can talk loud.
Yeah, it would be good. Thanks.
Is it okay to move this over here?
Sure.
Great, thank you all for having me. Yes, so I'm here to talk about a recent site visit that I took with some other folks from Burlington High School, as well as some students from Winooski High School. It was funded by the Partnership for Change, and I'm here to talk a little bit about just what that site visit was, what we saw, and that sort of thing. And so just to give a little bit of backgrounds, this year in Burlington High School, there's a pilot program of about six students who have sort of an independent study time to do transformation work within the school that supports the partnership's vision of student-centered learning. And so the work that I have taken on this year, as we sort of come to the end of the year, is exploring and looking forward to models of student leadership and school models and programs within the school that will support continued and authentic student voice. And so a lot of the work that I have been doing this year have been research and exploration of models that exist out there of programs that can support authentic and engaged student voice in school programming, in school policy, in school system, because I personally believe that if students feel like they have some ownership, some real voice in their school, they take their education a little bit more seriously or able to engage in a way that they couldn't before because there's a sense of responsibility to the community and to themselves. And I was fortunate enough to attend a leadership institute hosted by the Nellie Mae Education Foundation, which is the group that is currently funding the Partnership for Change. And while I was there, I had the opportunity to meet with someone named Jenny Wellington from the Pittsfield Middle High School in Pittsfield, New Hampshire. As I was talking to her, it became really clear that they had a really wonderful model of student leadership and student voice in their school, which was called a site council. And so what a site council is, that they exist in lots of different schools all over the United States. It's essentially a multi-stakeholder governing committee set within one school, and it's not district-wide, it's or sort of level of a school, it's set within one school. And Pittsfield's site council was really interesting and new because they had a majority student body. So I'll tell you a little bit more about what a site council is. So a site council within the high school, it is the governing body of the high school. So in Pittsfield, their site council approves or changes all of the policies within the high school. And that can be things like dress code, but it can also be things like discipline. It can be things about open campus policies. It can be what classes are being offered. Any changes in policy that are happening in the high school go through Pittsfield's site council. And so we got in touch, Hal Colson and I got in touch with some folks at Pittsfield, including the person who runs the site council, who is their dean of operations, Derek Hamilton, and organized a site visit. So it was a couple administrators, I went, some students from Winooski High School went as well, and we went to observe their site council. So we got a great presentation from Derek, who told us about the history of their site council, as well as we got the opportunity to observe their site council actually running. And what we learned was that their site council, it's made up of majority of students. They have, I believe, 10 students sitting on it. They have student representatives from every grade, as well as sort of every school club that is running through their school. It's a pretty small school. It's about the size of Winooski High School. They have teacher representatives from every department. They have administrators. They have a couple administrators from different departments. And they have three community members, one of whom is a parent, actually two of whom are parents, and one of them is not a parent. And they are all voting members, so every policy that goes through them is talked about and decided upon by all the stakeholders involved in the community. There are a couple non-voting members that include their dean of operations as well as some other administrators. And it's a total of 19 voting members, and I think it's about 21 members overall. It meets twice a month. There are open meetings. Anyone is welcome to attend. And essentially what it is this authentic governing body within their school that is primarily students. So you have primarily student voices governing the systems of this school. And I think the community's first response to this when they heard about the fact that Pittsfield was planning on trying out the system was, oh my gosh, the students are gonna run the school, things are gonna be super hectic, they're gonna wanna change everything, no homework, what are we doing, why are we letting students run our school like this? And actually what happened was the first thing that they wanted to tackle was their discipline policy. There was a number of students on the site council who had experience with the discipline system in their school, and they said, you know what, this isn't really working. And so they created a committee, and after a number of community conversations and some conversations with students and administrators, and after about a year of researching and working with some experts, they decided upon a model of restorative justice that really centered peer mediation. And so they created what is now called a justice committee, which runs all of the sort of peer-mediated discipline within their school, which is in their discipline system, someone files a report, it gets you, an administrator will decide whether it's sent to the Justice Committee or the discipline staff within the school. And it has been an overwhelming success so far. This is the first year that the Justice Committee was running. We got the chance to talk with some folks from the Justice Committee when we were visiting them, and they said that it has been handled, it's been dealt with very well. They're still learning a couple things and they're still doing trainings, but the conflicts that they have sorted out through the Justice Committee, these students have not come back, and they have not seen repeat offenders, and that sort of thing. Some other policies that were changed as a result of their site council had to do with open campus. So previously, they had trouble with keeping students in classes, keeping students on campus. And so the site council decided to sort of create a system by which if you were doing well in your classes, you have open campus, which means you can wander the hallways, you have an ID card that says you're doing well in your classes, and that sort of thing. So that was a policy that was decided upon by the site council. Changes in dress code was also decided on by the site council. Some changes in extracurriculars and co-curriculars, because Pittsfield is also supported by Nellie Mae, they are looking to expand a lot of their course loads, and it does mean that they've been able to support extended learning opportunities, learning outside the classrooms, internship opportunities. There's a couple things that have been happening there, and I think the thing that has struck me so much about this model of student voice and student leadership in the schools has been that it is the most authentic you can get. You have a majority student body governing what is actually happening in this school. And Pittsfield, I think, has done a lot of work to make sure that they're having as many voices from as many students on the table as possible. I think that's something that Burlington needs to be working towards doing as well when we're thinking about models of student leadership. And I think that this is certainly a great example of working to include that. And right now, as we're coming away, we are thinking of a couple next steps. This was just one model that we're looking at. There's another site council in Hanover that another site visit is being organized to visit. There are a couple students and a couple administrators going on that site visit as well. We're having conversations with students because we know that if you want to build an authentic place for student voice, you should begin with the students. Sort of, we're continuing to have conversations with folks about what they think authentic student leadership would look like, what they think would best support their voice, and certainly, if folks begin to say we don't think this model will work, we don't think that the sort of governing body will work, then of course we're going to listen to that and we're going to pivot and try and form a program and a model that will best support the students within our school, because Pittsfield and Burlington High School are very different schools. And we're also continuing to create leadership opportunities for students interested in this work. Right now, we're putting together what would be somewhat of a committee to help run the creation of the next model of student voice in our school. We're intentionally going out and recruiting students and teachers to be on this committee to sort of think about and plan what authentic and engaged student voice will look like in our school. That's all I have. I don't know if we have time for questions or not.
We do. We have 1 minute for questions, if anybody
has.
Great,
1 minute. Yes, Liz.
So this is really interesting and exciting, and it sounds like a great trip. And you said you're going to Hanover, too?
Right? I will not be able to go because I have AP tests, other people are going.
So, when you're talking, I imagine Pittsfield being this very kind of bucolic, rural, homogeneous community, and then I think about Burlington, which is bucolic and not homogeneous and not rural. And so did you, talk to students about, is my assumption correct? And similarly, would that be correct in Hanover compared to Burlington? And did you observe, or think about that when you were observing how the students conducted this process, what kind of applications that might have in Burlington?
Yeah, that's a great question. And certainly was one of the things that was on the forefront of our minds when we were going to look at them. That was something that we had a number of conversations with the group who was going beforehand, and we talked about the ways in which the schools look different or they look similar. Pittsfield has economic diversity, but not sort of ethnic or racial diversity in the way that Burlington has, and that was one of the first things that we asked about was how do you support a wide range of student voices on in your leadership spaces, because we know that leadership opportunities oftentimes present themselves to people who are able to make them. And so it has absolutely been part of our conversations and our considerations, and I think that's why at least I'm really eager to have conversations with folks who maybe are not often represented in our leadership spaces for students about what they would need to take advantage of leadership opportunities, because that's where we're going to find that information. It's absolutely something that we're thinking about and having conversations about, and I think that's a great question, and I think it's something we're absolutely holding as we move forward.
Thank you. Thank you, Zena. Appreciate it.
Thanks a lot.
And certainly, if you have any questions, you can get in touch with me or Hal Colston. We have charters and bylaws from their programs and that sort of thing. So.
Hey, Mark. Do me a favor. Is there anybody's name written down on the sign-in?
Xander, sign this.
No. There's nobody signed up, but is there anybody that wants to speak from the public? Okay. Thank you. Moving on to board training. This is going to be the first one that we've done in this case. What we did was I actually had constructed a conflict of interest procedure, a little bit of training for everybody so everybody understands. As we're coming into a lot of things right now, I want to make sure everybody understood where we sat with conflicts of interest and what you would do if you find yourself in a conflict of interest, what actions you would take. So it's not necessarily a bad thing, just a matter of making a declaration and letting everybody know, okay? So this is for the training. This fall, the school board will once again face one of its most significant responsibilities, the renegotiation of our collective bargaining agreement with the union representing our teachers. Preparation for these negotiations will be occurring well in advance of their commencement. As your chair, I believe this is an appropriate time to remind ourselves as board members of a couple of important responsibilities we must all adhere to for negotiations to be successful. First, we must be sure to avoid any and all real and apparent conflicts of interest in connection with this matter. We all need to be confident that we approach our positions and negotiations on the basis of the merits of the issues from the board's perspective, and not on the basis of any personal interest that may be conflicting. This is not only a legal requirement imposed by our state statutes, our board policies BBR and BIR, and Section 133 of the city charter. It is also a matter of appropriate ethics as a board member. The scope of this prohibition is not limited to our personal situations, but extends to situations where the conflict is created as a result of a relationship, personal or professional, to someone who would be in the conflict were they a board member. Consequently, if any board member or district manager believes that he or she has a relationship that precludes or reasonably appears to preclude complete objectivity, has any sort of personal financial interest in the matter, or cannot conduct preparation for or the negotiations process without being influenced by factors other than an objective consideration of the issues, such individuals should immediately recuse himself or herself from all discussion, participation, and voting throughout the negotiations process. The second issue relates to the executive sessions that board will have concerning negotiations. Our law allows executive sessions in such situations because premature public disclosure of the matters being deliberated will put the board and district as a substantial disadvantage. Consequently, all members are reminded that executive session conversations should be treated as confidential and held confidentially by all those participating. Thank you very much for your consideration and adherence to these important regulations. We have about a minute for discussion if anybody has one, please.
We're probably not gonna have enough time to really discuss this to the extent we should, and so perhaps it's something we could follow up on in the future, but a question I have, and I don't expect us to answer it right now, would be what kind of relationship would we have to have with someone affected by the contract for it to be considered a conflict of interest? For example, if somebody's partner is affected, is that a conflict of interest? If we're friends with teachers, is that a conflict of interest? Mm-hmm. If we're related to them? Because I think there's scopes of there's different kinds of relationships and different sort of concentric circles of connection. And if we extended it further enough, we would all be having a conflict of interest, because I'm sure everyone knows a teacher, right? So I think it's something to consider is, in advance, and this is in this situation, obviously, there's other situations. You gave us a specific example, but I said something to consider and reflect on is what kind of relationship would constitute one. Yeah.
No, and even the implied possibility. So it's not just that you have to, even the implied possibility of a conflict of interest is something to be declared. But actually, none of us can answer that. It's really something for Joe, who's going to be joining us later. So he'll be able to answer those if you see.
Later today or at another time?
Today.
Okay.
I just have a question. How do we define complete objectivity?
So we have a mission, and we have a goal as a board. Mm-hmm. We have the children at heart. That's it, right? So we have the vision that's given to us from the community, and we bring that vision down to the education for the children. And we can never vary. It always has to be for the children, right? So that's where the objectivity becomes. That it can't be, we really have to just take the issues of the board, and that's what we're going to go forward with it. Any other questions? Okay, and if you do, we certainly have an attorney that would help you make sure that we declare anything that should be declared. Okay, next up is the board report. We are running 5 minutes early. That's great. So on here we have four items to talk about. The first item is the dates for the joint retreat with Winooski. Hal had emailed me and said that we had seven people that had confirmed that they would join, that they would be there. Two that had not are the two commissioners that are not here right now. So I have sent them an email. If we can get nine, we'll do it. If we're not going to get nine, he probably said there's only four out of the five of them can be there.
I think they were looking for,
dates
they were
are we talking
proposing,
about?
We consider some
was it 30th?
30th was,
30th
I think
of what?
Winooski was back
May.
Here.
30th of May.
30th of?
May.
All right. So we're taking that date off the calendar?
Right, they were asking it to look at other dates too. So if we could.
It would have to be done in June. I mean, we can't go any further than that because then we run into our date, right?
Why can't it be done in, why does it have to be done in June?
Because in July we're having our own board retreat, so it's kind of, and that's a whole Saturday, so it's a long day.
We have a date for that?
We do not. That's another one of the agenda items down here.
Okay.
So let's just, does anybody have any dates that they cannot attend in June?
I can't attend the 20th, the 27th, or the 6th, most likely.
You sent me an email on that?
Yeah. I could try, though.
I have some conflicts, too.
I cannot.
You want emails?
Emails would be great. We can't do it here because I'd be running a calendar. Please.
Does anyone know how to use Doodle? Is everybody comfortable with that? Can we do something like that?
Doodle. Sure.
I've never used it.
I have no idea what you're talking about.
All right. Never mind.
It's like you're talking Spanish.
It's just a little online.
It's just a program that allows everybody to go in and check off the dates they're free and not free. And so one person can just look at that and capture all that. But it's up to Mark because I guess you'll be the person getting all the information.
I propose that Commissioner Porter get some fast training on Doodle probably within the next day or so.
Or just create an Excel spreadsheet.
I'll create an Excel spreadsheet and share it on Google Docs.
The Doodle thing's easy. I learned how to use it quickly when organizing the search.
Yeah. As your volunteer.
I can help you. It's really easy.
It is
really
actually create the thing for me, will you please?
I'll do that for you.
You're the best.
All right.
And then when you go in, it just walks you through
what
you need to do.
I'll do it while we sit here.
Okay.
The other suggestion was to maybe consider it, because Saturdays are problematic, to consider an evening, sort of a dinner meeting, an early dinner, through like a 9 o'clock. So if that's, I would encourage you maybe to consider to include evenings as part of your.
Yeah.
So Brian, June 8th is out. Actually, I'm gonna get to that.
June 8th is the middle of the week.
June 8th is a Monday.
Over the course of 2 weeks, like two Wednesdays or two.
Yeah. So let's find out when people can't go and then we'll find the dates that are best suited. What's left over, we can decide from there, okay?
You pull every date in June.
So am I making a doodle for every weekend in June? Like, so I'll say Friday, Saturday, Sunday, Friday evening, Saturday all day and night, Sunday all day and night?
Wait, no,
that's what
I just wanted to consider weekends.
Yeah.
What are you guys just working out?
You mean evenings during the week, too?
Yes.
Okay, so I'm going to, just to be clear, and I'll work on it right now, we're going to set up a doodle for evenings during the week, and Friday evenings, all day Saturday, Saturday evenings, all day Sunday, Sunday evenings.
Yeah, let's do that.
All right.
Let's do that. We'll figure it out.
This is for June, right?
For in June. I will limit it to June, 2015.
Okay. And make sure you take all nights off there for all our meetings and our committee meetings.
I won't count Tuesday nights. All right.
June 8th.
And June, oh my God.
Correct. Way to go, Brian. You are one heck of a volunteer. Any other discussion on the joint retreat with Winooski?
Thanks.
So we're going to get the dates pretty as quickly as possible.
June 8th is the mayor's
see what works,
dinner,
okay.
Anyway.
Next item is item B, which is the mayor's dinner for the city council. I think everybody responded back on this for June 8th, the evening of June 8th. Everybody's pretty comfortable with that. I think it was going to be a lot of fun. It's going to be great to get everybody together like that.
I can tell you the responses we've gotten. Anne has not responded, Kat and Mark.
About
dinner with the mayor.
Yes, I did.
I'll send it again.
Mark, can you do that now, please?
Pardon?
Yeah.
I have a question.
Go right ahead, please.
Is not to be high maintenance, but I'm going to be for a second. Is there a way to like, I don't know what the plan is for the food, and some people might have dietary or religious issues about food, so I'm wondering, is there a process to submit those to someone who's organizing this to make sure that it's inclusive of everyone?
We'll ask.
You'll ask? Okay, thank you.
Any further questions on the mayor's dinner? Okay. Next up is the consent to assignment of the Burlington Telecom MOUs.
So you have a memorandum from our distinguished city attorney who is here this evening in case we have any questions. This has to do with certain BT equipment on school property requiring MOUs, and all the material was in your packets. Don't need to go into a lot of detail unless anybody has any specific questions.
Howard, do you know the agreement on the Taft building was a little confusing to me. What's the situation? Is UVM going to honor that, or are we going to give them 120 days to get out?
Good. My understanding is that certainly the issue involving UVM was taken into consideration, but perhaps Eileen, you could speak to that.
Certainly, when the Taft School agreement was negotiated with UVM, there was discussion that the BT equipment was in the basement, and at the time we didn't have specifics about what this assignment was going to look like, but there definitely are expectations that the BT equipment would continue there as long as BT was being operated by the city. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, I guess. So UVM's made that agreement on that property?
So it is in the agreement with the Taft School that would continue. And this will be probably, I haven't talked to Joe and Colin about whether they want to send this on to UVM to let them know, but that would be a piece of it, just to let them know there's been this assignment.
Eileen, can I ask you a question? We have two items in front of us. We have the consent to the assignment of memorandum of understanding, and then we have the resolution relating to the consent to assignment of BT MOUs. Are we addressing both of those tonight?
Yes. Well, in the sense that I wasn't sure how you all operate, but the City Council generally operates by adopting a resolution, and in that resolution it says that you authorize the superintendent to sign the consent. That was just how I set it up.
Okay, so which of the two are we working with tonight?
So what you would pass is the resolution, which will then authorize the superintendent to sign the consent.
Does everybody understand that?
Somebody make a motion to that effect.
I will move the resolution to sign the consent, and I will read it into the record and then give it to Liz. That in the year 2015, resolved by the City of Burlington Board of School Commissioners as follows, that whereas the school commissioners and the City of Burlington entered into two memorandum of understanding, otherwise known as BTMOUs, in July 2008 concerning the location and use of certain Burlington Telecom buildings and equipment on school property, and whereas the City of Burlington has now entered into agreements with Blue Water Holdings, LLC, which contemplate the assignment of the BTMOUs to Blue Water Holdings, which shall lease them back to the city, and whereas the MOUs provide that no assignment shall be permitted without the advance written permission of the Board of School Commissioners, now therefore be it resolved that the Board of School Commissioners hereby consents to the assignment of the BTMOUs as provided in the consent to assignment of memorandum of understanding and authorizes the superintendent to execute the consent document and any related documents required to carry out that assignment.
Do we have a second?
I second it.
Any discussion? Lovely music in the background.
I just want to thank Eileen for preparing a resolution like that for us. We're not used to that.
Thank you.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All those against? Resolution passes.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Next up, and Brian, I think I'm going to need you again for something here, which is the July date. July, we need a July Saturday for the Burlington School Board retreat.
So you want me to create a doodle
one
that includes every Saturday, day and night? Well, night, day and evening, or just days? Like maybe 11 a.m. to 4?
Your morning bias is creeping in there.
I'm honest about my bias. I don't like mornings. So what are the parameters?
Last year, we had a retreat in June and one in July. And they were actually both on a weeknight because, remember, one turned into a public hearing at the Rock Point Bishop Booth Center. That was a weeknight, and then...
Wasn't the other one at Burlington College?
The other one was at Burlington College, and I think that was a weeknight.
Theirs was weeknight.
Yeah, they were both weeknights. Because I think in the summer, it's pretty hard for people to commit to a weekend.
So does two weeknights work better for people?
I would say...
Probably 3 hours each?
Sure. Yeah.
Discussion? Really, everybody can talk here. This is where I'm more than willing to listen to feedback on this.
I have no problem with that.
I think looking at weeknights creates a lot more flexibility than the four Saturdays does.
Okay.
By weeknights, what are we considering night? Because now the sun sets at like 8:30.
6 to 9. I like that, Mark. Six to nine.
Six-ish.
6 to 9, Brian.
Six. Well, I don't get out of work till 7. That's why I'm asking.
You can.
Can we go 5:30?
I'll put it on the doodle and we'll see what people say, and the majority will win, right? So,
not everyone. People that have kids might want to get home by 9 o'clock.
Start at 5:30, yeah.
Are we considering Saturdays as well? Or just weeknights now?
We're going to see if we can scratch Saturdays.
Would someone else want to create the doodle for this? Because you can? Okay, just so we can get it done right now and then it's less.
My doodle committee.
Thank you, everybody. Any further discussion on the board report? Superintendent's report. Commencing at 7:48.
Okay. Just a quick update. We've been getting periodic updates through my superintendent's organization regarding H-361. We talked about earlier this year. It's still alive. It came out of the Senate, and it's in conference committee. So as we get more information, I'll share it with you. But this is, you recall, was the proposed legislation. It's sort of being referred to as reform legislation, has the mix of sort of incentives and disincentives around issues related to school mergers or consolidations over time. Potentially, it originally included some provisions for the option for some kind of a cap on obligations of state increases in revenue around school spending and some other issues. So the general prediction right now is that it came out of the Senate in similar enough fashion so that the issues, any outstanding issues, can be resolved in conference committee, and they're expecting a bill will actually end up being adopted as a result. So if there's anything that's particularly notable, if we get some kind of an alert on that, you should be aware of, I'll make sure you get that information. So on tonight's agenda, we had, first was up was discussion of areas of focus for the new superintendent's entry plan. The Policy and Governance Committee had talked about, it started out in the general context of the evaluation model for a superintendent, and recognizing that in this case, with the new superintendent coming in, there's the first issue really has to do with kind of formalizing, having a little structure around the entry process, so that there's some agreement in expectations around what happens in the during the first few months, and the superintendent has the confidence of the board that is confident that the areas that he's focusing on are areas that the board has already kind of identified and endorsed, so that he's not running off in a whole bunch of different directions. Clearly, a huge part of the of that entry period for of the first few months just has to do with getting up to speed, networking, starting to build relationships, getting the lay of the land, getting the school year off to a successful start. So those will all be aspects that he'll be asked to kind of think through a little bit and lay out in some format in terms of kind of an entry plan concept. However, in addition to that, there are areas that the idea was to get him to start thinking about, and as he's meeting people and starting to get to know people, spending some time getting up to speed in some issues, that we provide some focus around areas where the idea would be for him to come up with more or less a plan of action as a product of this entry process. So, say by the end of October or some point in October, he would have some proposals around a plan of action to look at some of the areas that have been identified for him. You don't want to kill the guy in the first year, so be cautious about how long a list that you put together. 3 to 5, would be considered. 3 is right. This is good. So you're welcome to pare this down. These issues grew out of conversations that we've had internally, areas that seem to have emerged kind of organically as areas in need of attention. I'll just quickly make reference to each one and then open up for discussion. The whole issue of ELL program, English Language Learner program, and service needs and models is an acknowledgement that the district has been sort of having to build the airplane while flying it when it comes to the whole issue of trying to wrap our arms around the needs of students coming in, because it's not just about language. So it's a much more complicated picture for our district, and we're trying to build services and put together resources as we've gone along. I think that we've reached a point where it makes sense to try to pause, kind of take stock of what's working and what isn't, and then spend a little time looking at good models elsewhere. Because there are other places that have dealt with, there are other refugee resettlement communities in the country, there are other places that have dealt with the needs of a variety of children coming in representing a variety of languages and backgrounds. There are good models of instruction when it comes to English language learning. There are also some philosophical issues that have to be resolved. A fundamental one, for example, has to do with the notion of the extent to which, particularly when you get older children coming in, the extent to which you, in effect, segregate them at the beginning under the reasonable assumption you can't just plug them into chemistry and algebra and all these things right away without some orientation and some capacity building process. However, there are also risks that if you're not careful and to make sure that it is just an orientation program, it can become a permanent placement that in fact is separate and distinct from, as opposed to integrated with the school population. So there are a number of questions like that that should also be addressed in looking at the model. So it needs, it really should benefit from, at this point, from some serious study and then some recommendations growing out of that. Probably things that would need to be phased in, potentially, to really get the district where the district needs to be in addressing some of these issues. In the area of diversity and equity, actually somewhat of a similar notion of, again, trying to deal with issues as they've arisen, coming up with approaches, providing resources, trying some things out, and using, taking advantage of the opportunity now that we have a little data. We'll have in the fall another climate survey. We'll have the results of that. Using that data, using the information that we're getting in response to things like that survey and other other data we have, to kind of get a sense of, again, of what's working. What are the resources that we have relative to the needs that we actually have? Are we comfortable with the rate at which our capacity is being built around issues of sort of cultural proficiency, cultural competency at all levels? And this, by the way, this umbrella is big enough to include issues relative to hiring, not just students and staff. So again, pretty large area of significance for the district and deserving of some study and evaluation before kind of going onward and coming up with some some guidance as far as any direction going forward. Research and adoption of an administrative evaluation model. We have a fairly kind of an old model that is used. It's a goals oriented model where you identify goals that the administrators are going to focus on at the beginning of the year. You monitor the progress during the year. At the end of the year, you evaluate the success of in terms of achieving the goals and then set goals for the next year. It's not without merit. It generally speaking, would be an element of any process you go through, but there are also models that are well established now that are built more on research-based proficiencies around leadership and management, and contain pretty specific language that you can use to provide more specific feedback to people regarding their performance, and it becomes, it's a more useful tool potentially. So I think the timing is right to look at that. The other areas in has to do with administrative support. We have some fairly traditional models for administrative support in our buildings after the principal, which is assistant principal, and not much else. And at the elementary level, not even that. We have increasing responsibilities that administrators have, and there are a variety of functions. I think it's important to kind of step back and start to identify the kinds of support functions that the stakeholders that you serve require, those stakeholders being students, staff, and parents. They all have, sort of needs that need to be met at the building level and that need to be served by people at building level. And in some cases, some of the functions are not necessary things you need to go to graduate school and have a master's degree in order to provide. In other cases, it does require specific training and all of the assumptions behind leadership preparation. So really taking a look at what are some good models out there that are needs driven. If you really look at sort of thinking about your customers, how do you serve your customers? How can you leave your customers well served? Thinking about it through the different lenses of a child's perspective, of a staff member's perspective, or a parent's perspective, and then seeing where that takes you as far as what kind of support model to work towards in the future. Last one is last but not least, and that has to do with the whole notion of long-range capital planning. There clearly we've identified some issues associated with our buildings that are in need of attention. We're up against size limitations. They're deferred maintenance. Like a lot of school districts everywhere, there are spaces that are being used for purposes they were never designed for. Their technology has had an impact on how you use or how you need to use spaces in schools that has not been factored into the design of pretty much any of our buildings, and so on. The city has put together a plan that they're in the process of kind of vetting, but it's pretty well along. It's kind of a 10-year outlook that has implications in terms of going to the taxpayers to say at some point, you know, we're going to need support from you to authorize bonding in order to do some work. We've been starting to work more closely with the city and thinking about how we would collaborate with them in looking at needs mutually and recognizing that it's important not to be at cross purposes, for example, to be in parallel and all of a sudden both entities coming out maybe the same year and saying, oh, we both need some huge project that's going to require millions of taxpayer dollars. Clearly needs to be coordinated. We need to have a sense of what our needs look like over probably a 5 to 10 year period, and ultimately something that translates to kind of what the board could adopt and endorse as a kind of a facilities master plan, which would then set the stage for some kind of a phased approach to get where you need to be in the ways that have identified in that plan, whether it involves the you know, work at the high school or whatever. And as part of that, considering, are there ways to collaborate with the city? Are there ways, for example, a good example is libraries, where a typical model in a city this size from a library perspective would be to have a central hub, which you have in the city, but to also then have satellites. And in many cases, if you sort of cultivate the notion of a school as a community center, then the library in that school can become one of those satellites. And if you address that in terms of design and construction so that you can have separate entry and you can secure the rest of the building, that's a resource that instead of just being available on school days can become available, you know, evenings, weekends, summers, and so forth. And there are other examples of potential ways to collaborate with the city, particularly with regard to parks and recreation uses, also in the area of operations, and so forth. So that is I would really flag that as an important area because it really is the first step that you want to take in order to position the district to really evaluate what your needs are and when it seems to make sense to begin addressing them, in what sequence, over what period of time. So those are all in and of themselves daunting. It's a lot. I wouldn't necessarily expect that you get completely through each one of those in the course of a year, but as far as sort of directing the energies of a new superintendent, what I like about them, and then I'll stop and invite participation, but what I like about them is that it clearly identifies the needs of some of our most vulnerable elements of our population as being an area of focus, and acknowledges the reality, which is we are a work in progress in a couple of significant areas, and we really need to bring to bear some research, some best practices, some good models from other places, and hold what we're doing up to those and evaluate what the implications might be for the district going forward. And then the other notion is, if you're over time, again, I think the district is positioned to at a point where you can kind of sort of do a reset and we're kind of regrouping and moving forward with new leader over some period of time. And, you know, the proverbial, where does it start? It starts at the top. So starting with having a good evaluation model, starting with making sure you have good administrative support structure to get you going, I think would set the stage for a lot of other good work down the road. And then, you know, underlying it all is our facilities. I will say, and it's not a criticism, an observation, but if you walk through the schools and you look around, there's a certain tired quality to some of what you see in terms of the surfaces and the spaces and so forth. It's clearly sort of been loved a lot. and there's there are some needs that need to be attended to. And so I can't stress enough the importance, I think, of committing to some planning. And by the way, we'll be bringing a suggestion to ITC, which will then come back to you, that gets to more specific about how we might approach that.
Thank you. Can I ask that we suspend discussion on this because we're running behind right now? And that if you have questions, that you can just send them an email?
I would not. I'd like to say something.
We're staying late because of you.
Huh?
You alone. You alone.
I really.
I'll help you, Stan.
Please, if we can make it fast, it's fine. But we just can't. We could discuss this all night.
It's pretty quick. Yeah.
Do it.
Here it is. It's more like. Thank you very much, Howard.
that really helps a lot. The problem that we may run into is that on July 1st, we may not have the superintendent. Our contract reads he has to be in place by July 1st or, okay. So by the next meeting, we need to have a contingency plan in place so that we know what we're going to do for the superintendent. Because under this contract, we pay him only if he secures everything by July 1st. So I don't want to get caught paying $12,800 a month to a superintendent who can't do his job plus paying Howard. So I think we really need to reevaluate as a board how we're going to go with the superintendent.
No matter who's superintendent, these would be goals for the
Correct.
Okay. Absolutely. No, I understand that.
You understand? So we do have a plan B.
And could I just confirm, I thought I heard you say that, is it AOE that is asking him for the plan by when?
For the, no, this is just us.
Oh, okay.
This is just but for our purposes.
AOE is asking our new superintendent for a plan, correct? Is this informing that plan? Or is that separate? You mentioned an entry plan.
No, that entry plan is just for us. This is just for the board, board's purposes. Well, the only thing he needs to do with AOE is just the licensure piece.
Okay, so did I misunderstand? I thought AOE was expecting an entry plan.
No.
They're not?
No, this is just
So I did misunderstand.
Board.
Okay, thank you.
We are.
We are what?
Expecting an entry plan.
In
the contract, it says that he has to secure, and that's important. I don't want to wing it. Come July 1st. I want to really have a plan in action. Well, this is why we have a contract. That's all.
Any further discussion? Are we all set on this?
Just a general sense of comfort with the areas that I've identified?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Good. Yep. Moving on to budget impact items.
Okay. Budget. We went through a process. We put together a budget calendar. Maybe if you could put the calendar up first quickly, Paul. One of the things we recognized looking at when you actually have to be ready to propose a budget and go through the process of reaching approval, it's comes up very quickly if you wait till September to get started. So right after the budget passed in March, we turned our attention to, all right, let's look at this on a full year cycle basis and not lose opportunities between now and the fall to identify some areas for study and start to do some legwork. So you can see there, we identified April as a point where we would get input from the public and staff, which we have done, that translated to a raw list. And I want to make sure I clarify for people that list. A couple of people saw some things and got alarmed and perhaps interpreted them that they were actually budget proposals. All they are is what we promised people, which is we wouldn't edit the first list at all. We would just put it out, splash it out there. Anybody who made a suggestion, it would be on the initial list, the sort of the raw list. And so that was generated. We put that together. We put it up on our website, and then since then we've had administrative meeting, and we have a somewhat shortened list to review tonight. The idea in general is to identify some areas that we can begin looking at, take advantage of the time between now and the fall, so that the goal really is to be able to give the board a budget preview in October that plays out a lot of sort of what-ifs, scenarios, okay? If, you know, here's some things we've looked at, here's what it would cost. If we plug these into the budget, here would be some of the implications, and it gives you some time then between October and, the beginning of January, when you actually have to adopt, get serious about adopting a budget, to then do some more, have a more deliberative process in thinking through those issues, doing a little more homework, answering questions, inviting the public to comment, so that it's not all compressed to one public hearing just before a budget vote, for example. Hopefully by the time you get to the budget proposal, then there are really no surprises. Everything you've been thinking about has been out there. People have had a chance to talk about it. You know, they may agree or disagree, but it's been out there. So that's the idea. So if we switch from that to the list, that the first, if you just show the first list quickly, the original list that was put up there. So I'm not going to read through all of them. We just tried to categorize them, elementary, middle, high school, program service areas, areas of teacher support, facilities, and cost savings and efficiencies. So they'll continue to be on our website for anybody who wants to reference the unedited list. And then if we could switch to the list that, it's still a long list. And again, right off the bat, I have to sort of emphasize that there's, it's not humanly possible. I'm sorry, Mary, go ahead.
Just a question. I wonder if, since this is on the website and has created some confusion of the community about what these are, if it might be possible to just put some sort of explanation at the top,
sure.
Just a quick paragraph describing that. Thank you.
So we won't, these aren't necessarily, some of them to get into require a lot more time than others. Time and resources, and again, how far you can get through some of them, even if we start now, relative to the significance of some of them, is a little bit in question. But I just to take an example, if you look at the assistance in kindergarten classrooms, because that gives you an idea of what you could get into if you're seriously going to take a look at one of these items. If not surprisingly, both from staff and parents, there was continuing interest in looking at are there ways to provide assistance in kindergarten classrooms. As a quick reminder, there were paraprofessionals up until this year that are assigned to provide assistance in kindergarten classrooms. This year, there were not. And what that has done, however, is created an opportunity that we hope to be able to use to take a look at kind of a comparison of experiences with paras and without. So we have, I think, 4 or 5 years of data where we, with paras, prior to this year, we can go back and we can look at the growth of students. We do a screening at the beginning of the year, and then we do something at the end of the year. And so we have growth measures that we can make reference to in previous years. Now we can go to this current year and look at those growth measures relative to growth in this year. Obviously, this is just 1 year. But if there was some significant difference there in rate of growth, and we focus on growth, not absolutes, as you can appreciate, the cohorts can be different, they're different characteristics, it's not necessarily apples to apples, but if you look at, you know, just how far kids got in general, in the aggregate, from the beginning of the year to the end of the year, and make that as a comparison, gives you some idea. So one more relatively objective way to kind of look at the impact, since the only variable, the curriculum wasn't changed, nothing else, the class size wasn't changed, really the only significant variable that changed was they had pairs and then they didn't. So it makes for, you know, an opportunity to do some analysis there, as well as to try to get some other more qualitative data from teachers and parents around other sort of implications that they at least perceive had an effect on climate in the classroom, other kinds of issues in the classroom. So there's some legwork that you bring to bear around an issue like that, and hopefully then cost out, there are, for example, 3 possible ways we've already identified that you could address that. One is the traditional paraprofessional model, which to reinstate would cost at least $450,000 to add to the budget. Another one is to look at a different level of assistance through some combination of volunteers or other kinds of assistance that doesn't add up to the expense of full-time paraprofessional in every class, you know, shared paraprofessional, something like that. A third one that we've had identified and haven't had a chance to explore yet was the concept of kindergarten teacher interns using recent college graduates who haven't connected yet with their first job, so that you come up with a stipend, and you'd basically bring in somebody who's a freshman, a teacher, who could theoretically operate as a co-teacher, not just in a kind of a para role. So there, that alone, to do that properly would take a lot of work, and now you can see this whole list. So it's designed to illustrate the kind of work that you would hope to get into before you actually make a recommendation around a budget area. I flagged this one because I recommend that this one be given that kind of attention. Others we may not be able to devote quite as much attention to, but the idea would be to go through and as much as possible vet some of these things, at least identify issues, and be able to bring informed recommendations and share with people the kind of backup that we have behind them when it comes time to make budget proposals.
So how would we had the original list.
Yes.
Then you guys yesterday called that down to the new list. And then today you're looking for a recommendation from us to pursue the research of this new list for inclusion in the 2016 budget.
Right, and or to address, it doesn't necessarily imply that all of them would translate to a budget proposal. Okay. There are things to be looked at.
It's a pool.
It's a pool to look at. Pool is a good word.
Okay. We all know that these all came from the community.
Community members and staff members.
What's the difference between the two lists, the budget input summary one and the budget input summary R?
The R is the revised.
The revised one. Okay, the first one was just the raw list, unedited.
Okay, thank you.
And the second one is having gone through and identified areas to that we think we can at least spend some time on, and it would be potentially fruitful or productive to spend some time on.
Commissioner Curry?
I think other people had their hands up first.
Commissioner Stoll?
Rock, paper, scissors.
All right, somebody just go ahead and talk. I'll let you guys.
Okay.
Way too polite.
Just a question. Did you have some sort of criteria that you looked through the big list? How did you narrow down from the big list to the little list besides just what seemed plausible?
Pretty much that. Okay. I can't confess to that or, you know, pretend that there was a huge science to it. We brought together our entire administrative team and tried to get a sense from them of whether or not the issue seemed to be of substance that, and also we could take a look at some of these things and bring, there was some potential validity to it. There are a couple that were, not necessarily informed by accurate information. So at some point, if somebody asks, we can follow up and say why that didn't make the list. There were, again, it's probably 75% of it is still there. But there were some that just, for a variety of reasons, didn't make sense to expend a lot of energy on. Or we didn't think the timing was right to get to it for this budget cycle.
Are we allowed to ask specific questions?
You can. We got like 1 minute.
All right, I'll ask it. I'm curious. I'm looking at the list and comparing them, and I know this is like one of the things I've been concerned about, so maybe I noticed it quicker, but I'm noticing that restored social worker positions is gone from program service areas, and there were 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 items. But then in the new list, there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 items, and no social workers mentioned, although I see the addition of adequacy of family support services. So I'm just curious why one is off and another's on, and what's the thinking behind that?
So when we went over the list, first of all, we went over it for whether it included everything. A couple additional areas came up. So the general notion of family services, family support services came up. It's just that it's pretty abstract at this point, but it was recognized as a potential area of undermet need worthy of some investigation. The social worker piece we took off because we felt that we need to have a year of, just like I was pointing out with the kindergarten experience, we actually need to have a year of data without the social workers to use as a basis for evaluating the implications of that before we get into the question of whether or not to increase them. If we turn right around in the fall and start talking about increasing, we have no experience base to know. We won't have a year under our belt with the new intervention team model or any other basis for evaluating the impact one way or the other of reduced social workers. So that's why that one came off for this current year. And that's why we're having the conversation. We can put it back on. Our concern would be we wouldn't have any data to use.
Right. Yeah, I guess I hear that, and just to respond, I hear that, and I respect the idea, but there's something that doesn't resonate with me about the idea of, like, we're going to test what a year of depriving children of something does to see, you know, like, there's something about that. And maybe I'm framing that wrong, but that's kind of what it sounds like.
So I would take exception to framing it that way. Just as a very quick frame of reference, I won't go into it, but if you, this is where the objectivity comes from coming in from the outside. If you brought in somebody, not just me, who would, and looked at Burlington, and there were no services at all. And you said, all right, what's a reasonable service to support with your school budget for different kinds of services? I would be surprised if you got a recommendation that if the support services model already included a full-time counselor, already included substance abuse prevention counselor, already included psychologist, that there would be, in addition, a recommendation for, let's say, a full-time social worker in every building. I might be wrong. So in other words, I think that when we went through all this, when we came up with the model for this year, one of the problems is making the assumption that what you have was optimal, and somehow you're reducing from optimal. Now, maybe what is optimal should have been twice that. Who knows? But it was a somewhat arbitrary amount to begin with. It wasn't by design necessarily. It was kind of by default. And so, you know, we went through a process and came up with a model that we felt was more comprehensive in looking at the needs of all students around intervention. And that model involved increasing our school psychologist staffing and decreasing social work staffing, but leaving a commitment in every building. I'll stop because I know we've had the conversation, but just as a quick context for how we got there, and not to say that we can't look at it, it's just that I don't know what we would have to bring to the conversation in October after, or November, after just a couple months working with this.
Okay. We're going to have to move on.
Well, I'm sorry. I would like to ask that this be a standing item on the Finance Committee agenda, because I think it's important that there be a process that allows for board engagement. I have a lot of comments and questions about this, and I feel like there hasn't been a process outlined that allows for board engagement. And we just heard in our VSBA training before this meeting that it is the board's role to engage the community on the budget. And so in order for that to happen, I think we need to articulate a process where the board has access to this conversation regularly to engage the community and do our job. Thank you.
Okay, I'm going to go ahead and move from discussion on this. We're going to move on to the next item, which is the approval of the consent agenda. Commissioner Curry.
I'd like to move the consent agenda and pull it off to discuss. Is that what I'm supposed to do?
Okay. Of which we need a two-third agreement to pull the consent agenda.
Second.
To allow discussion.
Do we get to know a reason, or do we just have
you
to say yes?
Right,
okay.
Second. So moved. All those in favor of pulling the agenda? Jeez, let me finish.
Well, I want to know why.
All those in favor of allowing the pull of the consent agenda for discussion, say aye.
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 All say nay.
I'm unsure of this. In the past, and perhaps we've been doing it wrong, but we used to remove one item from the consent agenda to discuss, so we knew what we were going to discuss. Was that procedurally wrong, what we've been
doing
in the past?
You should have pulled the whole consent agenda. It is open for discussion when it's been pulled for anyone.
So that's procedurally correct, so now we're doing the correct way. Okay, in that case, I vote yes.
Okay, Commissioner Curry.
Thanks. So first I have a question, and then I just wanted to follow up with that. But I noticed that there's a large number of recommendations to hire on the consent agenda. And my question is, were the hiring procedures that we have in place followed for all these people? Because I know our hiring procedures can be lengthy. And so this was a lot of people to go through that process.
So this began in February. One of the reasons we did the incentive for retirees, for people retiring, to let us know they're retiring so we'd have early notice. So we posted, and we had a number of people, I think 18, who retired. And then we've had, since that time, people have resigned. So we actually had a significant number of positions to fill. But we began the process, you know, in February. So it's what typically happens, because it is a lengthy process, and you only have monthly board meetings, things tend to bunch up, and there's been a lot. We've gotten down to the final stages of the hiring process in the last month in many cases, and so they're finally clearing that last phase of the process and coming before the board now. You'll have a few more in June, but this is the bulk of them.
Okay. So I just wanted to speak a bit to the hiring process procedures, because the procedures we have in place were created under the Diversity and Equity Committee when it was a new committee, and the procedures were identified as a strategy in the Diversity and Equity Plan as a way of having an affirmative hiring process in the district. So My question is, were the procedures followed for these positions? And by that I mean there is a kind of a proactive approach to assessing, open and fair application process and having people who apply go through a couple of interviews with a couple different stakeholders and also look at a scoring sheet around, kind of their cultural literacy and proficiency. And so my concern is that procedure is followed where it is supposed to be followed. It's not clear to me if it's every single position or administrative positions, but I would like to understand affirmatively that it was followed so that, we understand that the strategy that was put in place is effective.
I can speak just generally, and I know, Nikki, if you want to add anything as far as the any specifics around following the procedure, but as it was explained to me and as I've monitored it going on, beginning with using trained people and only trained people to screen resumes to begin with, and using the criteria and a checklist and so forth, my understanding is that has been the process that's been followed. And then again, getting down to selection committees at building levels, same thing, only trained people can be part of that process. Questions are developed in advance and vetted in advance to make sure that they're appropriate and cover the range of issues and issues that are important to the district so that can be brought into the conversation around interviews. The process of identifying people, I'm just backing up for a second, coming out of the initial screening, as it was explained to me, again, my understanding has been followed in terms of the scoring and the weight that's attached to certain criteria in order to make sure that every opportunity is given for to bring a diverse, whatever diversity exists among in the applicant pool to make sure that there's attention paid to that. But Nikki, is there anything you would add as far as or any area where there were issues with following the process?
I couldn't hear clearly what your concern was.
Those mics might be on.
Well, my computer's plugged up over there. So as I was saying, by and large, the professional hires, assistant principal and principal hires, that's a fairly lengthy process. And by and large, I would say that it was followed, even though sometimes I didn't necessarily agree with the results. But generally speaking, that was followed. As for the teaching positions, we've had a number of processes that have taken place that are slightly different than what we typically would do. We did have the retirees and sort of had to wait for them, which put us behind a little bit in the schedule to wait for them to let us know they were retiring under the incentive program. That did occur. But then we went into a transfer process, which was basically an internal process, which was a little unusual because that's not typically how we do a transfer process, which, as I indicated at the D&E committee, concerned me a little bit because we have primarily internal hires at this point. We've hired approximately 25 to 30 people at this point, and virtually all of them are internal. And it concerns me that 4 out of our 6 elementary schools, which is where we would get most of our success around hiring new culturally competent teachers as well as teachers of color, is usually where they come in, is through the elementary school. And 4 of our elementary schools at this point have not hired an external person yet. They've only hired internal.
Could you elaborate, Nick? I'm not sure, when you say it doesn't follow our normal transfer process, is that, were we bound by union rules? Who decided? Okay.
Yeah, so normally what happens in a transfer is we have, the way the contract operates is that you put the position, you post the position, and we have a period of time where it's internal only. And that's the period of time where teachers typically will request a transfer to a different building. And then the principal has the discretion to decide whether to select that person or not. And under our current process, if they don't select them, they can then still apply for the job during the external process. But so by us having a transfer process, we sort of had a period. Howard, you'd have to tell me how long that period went.
I think, well, it was, for the most part, it was just like that 10-day period, you know, before, you know, for internal, and then it went external, I think.
Right.
It extended longer because the starting period varied depending on the opening. So when there was a particular vacancy posted, that the internal posting period, I think, was like 10 days, and then it switched.
Right, that's after we went through that original process, though, where we actually sort of told your transfer process, that's I call it yours because it wasn't mine, but your transfer process where you basically you told teachers if they want to transfer, they need to make contact with the principals, which is sort of that second part of a process that we sort of ended up with a dual process that was going on, and it sort of created some confusion for some people. But that wasn't my issue. My concern was that at this point, it's May, and we still don't have many external hires, which doesn't do a lot for climate change or anything else that we were trying to accomplish. So, and I've already said this to the Diversity and Equity Committee, so it's not anything new. Yeah.
So, it's new for me since I wasn't at the committee, so I'm just hearing it, so thanks right. for telling it to us again here. But if you do an internal transfer, though, don't you end up with an opening at the other school? Would you then do an external process for that? So are those going on now?
Well, that typically would be the case. However, as you recall, we did have some cuts. So that has not completely been the case. In addition, we had the math interventionist, the literacy interventionist. And as I look at this page, none of these were teachers that were like losing their position, so they were moving from one place to another. So the hope is that will happen, but right now we don't have as many positions. We may have another 15 to 20 positions. My hope is that they'll be external and it'll balance itself out, but right now it is certainly a concern that we've never had, at least I shouldn't say we never have because I haven't been here forever, but I haven't seen this many internals all at the beginning of the hiring season. Typically, it's the reverse. It's almost always at the end that there's just jobs open and it's late and people start selecting internals. This has sort of started early and we're late in the process and I'm not seeing it change.
One of the things that sort of contributed to that was that, in fact, we did have a list of potentially a long list of positions that were eliminated. And so because that, for example, like, I don't know, 10 or 11 special ed teacher positions, and the alternative to creating an opportunity for people to move and be and, you know, see if their talents lined up, for example, with literacy and math, would be to just have laid off all those teachers. So because we wanted to give them an opportunity to be considered for an alternative assignment in the district before we actually had looked at laying off somebody, that's what I think that contributed to. Again, that's like 10 or 11 positions all of a sudden that were essentially filled. If we were just creating 10 new positions, a couple people might have been interested, and we weren't laying anybody off, a couple people might have been interested to transfer. The rest would have been open, you know, potentially, and then it would have had external. In this case, we pretty much filled them all internally because the alternative was not to have a job. Now, we didn't force it, because it was understood and the union understood this, that if we didn't have properly qualified people internally, we're going to have to cut it off at the, you know, the level of those who were qualified, and whatever positions were left would be then opened up. So that was sort of an impetus for making sure we, and as a result, by the way, of the process that we followed, we ended up having to lay off very few people.
So I would just like to make a motion, and I'll explain why I'm making a motion, to approve the consent agenda conditioned upon all the hirings going forward following the procedures that have been in place since they were created. And if they can't be followed, if there needs to be a deviation, that the superintendent return to the Diversity and Equity Committee to discuss the reasons for the deviation. So I'm making that motion. If it has a second, I'll speak a little bit more to it.
I would second it for the sake of discussing it further.
Thank you. So the reason I brought this up tonight is because at the last Diversity and Equity Committee meeting, there was confusion around whether hiring procedures were being followed appropriately. And I just want to speak to those hiring procedures. The reason I'm elevating them to this level is because, as was stated in the vision statement opening this meeting, which was about making the district as equitable and inclusive as possible, and as we'll hear later in the equity report card, that the equitable, I would say, representation among our staff and leadership is, as you know, is part of the civil rights issue of our time, and as has been on the table for discussion since we had a diversity and equity plan, the strategies in that plan, the goal there is for them not to be an overlay and an adjunct on what we do, but really the lens through which we conduct ourselves. And so my concern at the Diversity and Equity Committee was hearing that there were instances arising where we needed to make exceptions to the hiring process, and that the hiring process is kind of, I understand, getting a little muddled. With all due respect, Howard, to the situation you're in, I know it's very challenging given the time frame that you have, and I know you have the best interests of the district at heart, and I'm not putting you on the spot. I just want to be doing diligence that I'm required to do as a board member to, you know, to be accountable to the procedures that we put in place and make sure that they are being followed, because it's easy for them to get derailed when we are crunched and we have a lot going on and we have a lot of turnover and we have the need to make exceptions and that sort of thing. I'd like to make sure that when there is a deviation, it's clear and it's been discussed with the committee, but that going forward, all best efforts will be made to follow the procedures that were put in place by the Diversity and Equity Committee when Director of Human Resources was hired.
I'd like to just echo and support Commissioner Curry's comments, and that is, when I look at it, the thing that I'm most interested in is that we set some goals for the district and that we hold ourselves accountable to moving forward. And I think there are some sort of mutually exclusive situations that arise. So if we, on the one hand, decry the fact that we have a district that, depending on where you measure it, but 25 to 30% non-white, and that we have a faculty that's 1 to 3% non-white, and that's problematic. So everyone objectively says that. It seems like sometimes there's some lack of follow-through in the necessary things to change that. Without doing certain things, that would remain the same. And unless we, when we're in that objective place, put things in place that, based on other districts' experience, professional best practices, have shown a record of being able to move forward and stick to them, it won't change. And the consistency that Commissioner Curry is speaking about is critical, because then it allows it not to become personal. And what I feel like, even if I'm not in touch with it, when things come up, it's about an individual. There's always going to be an individual. There's going to be an individual who's applying internally. There's going to be an individual who's looking for an interim. There's going to be an individual who people have a personal connection to. And without the policy that is consistent and stuck to, then you're in a jam, and it makes it, or it can be, well, you know, that was about some kind of quota from that. No, it was about a policy. And if it's policy all the time and you follow it, then there is some integrity to the process. So I'm just concerned that things do always happen, and there's always circumstances that come up, but without sticking to things we say, in 10 years, we could be in a similar position, because the inertia is moving against us, that we're swimming upstream to really try to achieve these goals. It is a serious uphill, upstream swim, and unless we have conviction and commitment to do it, we'll just, in 10 years, we'll say, wow, how'd that happen? You know, we're where we were. Because this conversation happened, I've been here, some people have been here since 95. This isn't a new conversation in Burlington. The numbers might be less than in the late 90s, quite frankly. I'm through.
A clarification question about, is this a...
Speaking to
you. Oh, the clarification question maybe for you, Liz. Is this a, are our hiring methods that we've used recently that we have, are those a policy? Are they written into our policies? Are they a board level policy, or are they a procedure that is, how the policy is actionable? That is then. So I'm just curious.
They are not a policy. They are procedures that were part of the diversity and equity plan, and the plan is submitted to the board for it's acceptance, and that's supposed to happen annually. I think it didn't happen last year because we didn't have a superintendent left at the end of the year to do it. And this year, I think there's pieces of it that are being submitted, but it's not a policy, it's procedures. And as a board member, it's my role to do diligence that procedures are being followed in a plan that we accepted. But yes, it's a good distinction because it's not that we would get involved in any policies about, you know, recruitment and hiring, but that's not really a policy. That's just more hiring recruitment procedures.
And to that point, by the way, on behalf of the new superintendent, what I would encourage is that I think we need to create a one-stop shopping repository so that you can actually point to where it all resides in one place in writing, so that I found, you know, pieces of it and was not aware of certain things. And so I think it's important to have it, to try to go put it all in one place so that it's easy to follow.
Well, okay. I mean, it's my recollection working with the Director of Human Resources that it is all in one place. Where it resides, in the realm that she oversees, I believe.
The hiring procedure is in writing.
That's
an HR document. There's some other pieces that are sort of float around it.
That's what I'm referring to.
Yeah.
Any discussion from anybody that hasn't spoken yet?
I have another clarification question because I wasn't entirely sure what the intent of your motion was, Liz, with the modifier in the middle of it, approve the consent agenda contingent on. So I'm not clear on whether you're intending to move, whether the motion intends to move support of the consent agenda, and if it turns out that the hiring procedures weren't fully followed, that you would like the superintendent to report, then the board would be asking the superintendent to report to diversity and equity about that, or whether the motion to approve the consent agenda only approves the hires if it turns out the procedures were followed.
It was to approve the consent agenda, and that going forward, all hires from here on out follow the procedures in place based on what's in the diversity and equity plan.
So why don't we,
and that if there needs to be a deviation, that the superintendent or the Director of Human Resources come to the Diversity and Equity Committee and request that deviation so there's a chance to discuss it and understand why it's being requested.
So why don't we approve the consent agenda so there's not a contingency on it, and you make a motion that the furtherance of the procedures will be followed or be reported to him. So we need to do a friendly amendment to the agenda, to the motion.
No, we can't do that. The motion's already been discussed, so we have to vote on the motion that Liz put in play earlier.
Be prepared to come back with another one, because this one I won't support because there's a contingency on it that could disqualify it in the future from ever happening.
That could disqualify what?
If we approve the motion the way it is right now.
Right. Yeah, I got you. Okay.
See what I mean?
Yep,
so just,
yep. So why don't I just withdraw the motion?
There you go.
Okay. And we'll just move the consent agenda.
I'd like to make a motion to approve the consent agenda.
I'll second that.
All those in favor say aye.
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 Against? Passes.
I'd like to make a motion that all future hiring follow the hiring procedures and the diversity and equity plan, and that if there needs to be a deviation from them, that the superintendent or the director of human resources come to the diversity and equity committee to discuss the reasons for the deviation.
Do I have a second?
Second.
All those in favor, please say aye.
Can I discuss it now?
Yeah, I discussed it.
Yeah, I thought we had to hear.
I just want to say that I will not be voting for this motion. It's not that I don't like the spirit of it. I do think it's a good spirit, and I think we should be following our procedures. I think that's important. But I would be more comfortable not putting another layer of responsibility for the superintendent and the director of human resources to report again to the school board on a specific issue. I will not be voting for this, but I would hope that the superintendent would take away from this discussion that the board feels it's very important for us to make sure that we follow our procedures and that we really care about this. So I just wanted to say that.
I just want to reinforce, I think it's important in our deliberations and dialogue that we be clear about what we're talking about and goals. So I would agree that with Liz that probably the mechanism in place to oversee or a place to report back to this in diversity and equity. But I feel that in the politics of what happens most places and here in town, that would do a disservice to the broadness of what's being said, that in our hiring there are multiple goals, some of which fit maybe neatly into diversity, equity, but some I would just argue just quality goals, and that there is a value to casting the net wide. In my experience, I would say I've observed processes in the past, for example, with the interim superintendent. I think it would have been a much more expedited process than the deliberative process we turned out with. And there were a lot of local and internal candidates, et cetera, but I really like where we ended up. And it was because there was a process that was followed that was more time consuming, but it yielded something that I think really helped quality, and it brought in some perspective, a 30-year career in a different community that I think has benefited the district. So for me, that's an example of why Liz's motion is really important in this process, and it's more because people focus on diversity and equity and things like, you know, affirmative action quota plan, and that really would be a disservice to, I think, what Liz is getting at and what this board wants to support. So the policy following, the procedural following, has some pretty broad implications that are important to the work we're doing, I believe.
Commissioner Kurt?
I would like to say I agree with Miriam on not having that in this motion. And that if you're going to vote for a motion with 138 policies or 140 policies, whatever we have, and procedures and HR documents, I haven't seen this document, so I'm definitely not going to vote for a document I haven't seen. So just keep that in mind as you vote on telling, having the HR and the superintendent go to a policy that, I mean, I can bet that most of the people sitting around this table haven't seen that document. Some of you have, I'm sure, but I bet all of you. You have to be careful of what you're voting for without knowing. I mean, we're not lemmings.
So, am I correct in saying that, Kyle, you would like, if there are procedures that are not being followed, that the hiring committee, what's it called? Hiring committee? Go to the superintendent and say this is not being followed, and the superintendent comes to the board and explains that it's not being followed? Is that what you're suggesting?
I'm sorry, you asking me a question?
Yes.
Okay, so just to clarify, the affirmative hiring procedures that the district has, we don't have a policy, we have procedures, reside in the diversity and equity plan, which those procedures were one of the strategies in the plan. The plan was submitted by the superintendent, the former superintendent, to the Diversity and Equity Committee, which recommended it to the board for acceptance. The board accepted that document. So all I'm suggesting is that if the superintendent or the director of human resources wishes to deviate from those procedures, that they bring that discussion to the Diversity and Equity Committee to discuss and make them aware of the reasons for the deviation so that it's on the record. I didn't suggest it come to the board. I didn't suggest there be any action. I didn't suggest there's any policy. All I suggested is that the deviation go to the committee so there's an open discussion, and so committee members have a chance to understand the rationale, provide feedback, and document the deviation. Thank you.
So will the procedure be changed to include that clause, basically, or?
That's what this motion would do. This motion would say, for, you know, this fiscal year, for these hirings going forward, we'd like to follow the procedures. If there's any reason to deviate, please come and discuss that reason for the record and establish it before it happens.
But the hiring procedure that exists, would it be amended to include this clause?
I don't believe the procedures would change unless the Director of Human Resources and the Superintendent actually said the diversity and equity plan that includes this strategy needs to change. Like if they said we want a different strategy for hiring, that would just be part of their plan next year or something.
I'm just going to say something because I haven't spoken yet. I'm not going to vote for this, but just only for the reason that I think the procedure, bad word in this case, should be that Commissioner Curry's team undertake a policy on hiring. That would be then the directive toward the superintendent. The superintendent would have to report on the success of the policy being adhered to.
But apparently,
could you say that again from the beginning?
No, create a policy. To create a hiring policy. and that policy is a directive to the superintendent. We actually work with the superintendent and his team to come up with something that works, that they can report on, that works for them. They create the procedures that live within that policy. They then, as part of that policy, they report back to us on a schedule that we determine.
That's what you're suggesting.
That's what I'm suggesting. So I'm not going to support the motion on a procedure. I'd much rather just take a month or two and build the right policy that should have, maybe could have been built all along. Anybody else that hasn't spoken yet? Oh, you had a question.
Well, I've got the 2014-17 Strategic Plan for Diversity and Equity open, and I can't find anything in it. Like, I can't find these procedures in it. There seems to be, in several places, the directive that departments should have hiring plans, that there should be affirmative hiring plans. I am 100% in full support of doing that, but it's not clear to me that your motion is pointing at the right document.
So just to be clear, my motion doesn't include the document. The document was an explanation. The document on the web may not be the document that I engaged with. That has been known to happen in the past, that the correct document doesn't end up on the web. I can't tell you specifically. I think that's something we could certainly ask Nikki Fuller to follow up on and to present them. They've been presented to the committee. They've been vetted. There was a process of creating them. This is just institutional memory. I can pull out old minutes. I can do all that for you after the meeting. I did not quote the plan in my motion. My motion was only to say there are procedures in place. The procedures were represented to us as a strategy in order to support the plan. So, and the other thing I would like to say while I have the floor is that it is not the board's role to create a policy on hiring for the district. That's the superintendent's role. That's what the previous superintendent did. I would be happy as the policy committee chair to take up that issue and research it, but I believe what I've heard from the VSBA is that it's not really the board's role to create policies on hiring. That's a superintendent function. So that being said, I'll just leave it at that.
Any further discussion? Could you reread the motion?
So the motion is, I don't know, Liz might already have it down, but the motion is that from this point on, for the rest of the hirings that are open for, let's say, the upcoming fiscal year, that the hiring procedures that are in place be followed, and if there needs to be a deviation of those procedures, that the superintendent and or the director of human resources bring those up for discussion, the deviation request to the Diversity and Equity Committee with a rationale for the deviation from the procedures.
Okay, I'm going to ask for a vote. If you could raise your hand, please, so we can get a count on this one, because it might be close. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Say aye. One, two. All those against, please raise your hand. Say nay.
Nay.
One, two, three, four, five, six. So the motion does not pass. And the consent agenda is closed. Moving on. We are in. Oh, please.
Just as I've been sitting here, Ann Jensen, I was supposed to swear her in.
What'd you do while you're sitting right there? You got it ready? And you guys stand up.
Thank you for remembering.
Oh, yes.
Thank you for remembering.
This is big stuff.
Sorry. Does that mean all of your votes don't count?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, she's not even present.
That might change things, huh?
Okay.
Did we have to start over?
So, you repeat after me. I, Ann Judson, do solemnly swear or affirm, whichever one you want. That I will faithfully execute the office.
That I will faithfully execute the office.
Of the Burlington Board of School Commissioners. To the best of my judgment and ability according to law. To the best of my judgment.
To the best of my judgment.
And ability according to law.
And ability according to law.
So help me God, or under the pains and penalties of perjury, if you can pay.
So help me God.
Okay. You good? Oh, I need to.
Moving on to the curriculum committee report.
Thank you, Commissioner Porter. So the curriculum committee actually met just prior to this meeting this evening. We continue apace with our effort to educate the committee about what's happening in the district as it relates to the type of assessment and data collecting we're doing that might help us identify movement towards the committee's stated goal of moving all Burlington School District students to language or literature proficiency by third grade. So they would be at grade level in literacy by third grade. That's our overarching goal. And specifically tonight, we talked about summer learning opportunities. And Dylan McNamara and Stephanie Phillips walked us through what the various opportunities are in the district. And just to give an overview, what became clear is, like many other things, those programs, well, two things. One is, per Howard's description earlier, using the kindergarten paras as an example of having an opportunity to see what happens when you add a resource and when that resource is absent. The same thing, we discovered there's really not good data, so we couldn't come to you all and report to say that these expenditures in the summer and these programs have this direct concrete effect, which meets our vision and mission and fulfills these goals. There really isn't the data to do that. So in these constrained economic times, that doesn't seem adequate that that is the case. So we're moving towards trying to understand that because there's significant pressure on those programs. Those programs disproportionately serve our most vulnerable youth, whether it's special needs populations, low income, ELL, students who are below the benchmark. And one example is the SOAR program, which is the broadest and one of the larger summer programs. I was looking at a chart, but about 20% of the funding for that came from the pilot funds, which will no longer be here. So just an example of one place where they're really financially vulnerable. So that just made us understand that getting in line, much better framework for being able to set goals and then collect the data that would give us some reasonable information about how we're moving towards those goals is critical. We're not there, but that's a lot of the work going forward. So we'll continue. The next meeting will be helpful. We'll look at year-end testing, which will give us some information about growth of students during this school year and give us a starting point for those students moving into summer. A benchmark to move from as we go into summer, and those students, some of which will take advantage of summer learning opportunities to look at summer learning loss, which is one of the things we're also been concentrating on.
Thank you, Cole. Thank you very much. Diversity and Equity Committee report, please.
So I'm covering for Stephanie Seguino tonight. Diversity and Equity Committee is working on a lot, but tonight we're going to focus on hearing from Deverne Bell, who is the Director of Diversity, Education, and Engagement for our district. And Deverne is going to share some highlights from our Equity Inclusion Data Report. And I have some paper copies here. If anyone on the board or in the audience here tonight would like a copy, I'll hand them out. But I'd like to turn the mic over to Deverne so that you get the most amount of time possible to present to us. Thanks.
Take one, Brian, while you're close. Mm-hmm. I'll take one, I said, while you're...
Yeah, because 10 minutes is not a lot of time.
No, okay. So go for it.
Okay, what I want to try to do is give a overview summary of what I see as the richness, the challenges, the top priorities, the needs, the progress, and some successes that we've had. The demographics in Burlington School District are not what they were 10 years ago, nor would they be what they are in the future. We're looking at about 30% of students of color. We're looking at over 60 different languages spoken in our schools. We're looking at, unfortunately, in some of our school buildings, a rate of poverty over 50%. So we've got rapid diversity changes in our district, but I actually see that as an asset, because it truly is preparing our children to live in the reality of the society of the world that we're in and the world of the future. So our population, when we talk about diversity, encompasses race, ethnicities, cultures, multiple languages, socioeconomic status, issues of identity. And we think that issues of identity, sometimes we're only looking at them as children get older. Recently, we're dealing with those issues in the elementary schools. So that kind of gives you a simple description of the complex demographics of what Burlington School District looks like. There's one other component that I add into that issue of diversity is our children who are dealing with complex traumas. You know, I don't think we or nationally, this district or nationally, have been prepared to deal with children that are dealing with complex traumas in their lives. So, with the rapid growth and change comes challenges, the need for resources, and a definite a game plan to being proactive rather than what being reactive. When I did a comparison of the data from last year's report, which focused on 2012-13, this year's report focused on 2013-14, we were still looking at comparing the same groups, and unfortunately, I don't have real positive news to say that the disparities in academic achievement have decreased. In fact, they pretty much have remained the same. And those, when we're looking at those groups, we're looking at it based on race, based on ability, based on limited English proficiency and socioeconomic status and gender. The in-school suspensions, there was a small decrease in female for in-school suspensions, but there was a notable increase for Black, Hispanic, and children on IEPs. The out-of-school suspensions, there were small decreases in gains in all the groups. On a positive, we can say and report that the dropout rates have improved for all groups. Unfortunately, we are still seeing a small to moderate drop in academic achievement for all groups in reading and in math. There also continues to be significant gaps in achievement between white students and Black students. So when we look at our challenges, one of the questions comes up, what are our major needs? And what I feel and the Diversity and Equity Office feel are top priorities. In the report that you have, it says teacher leader and quality. And when I say that, I don't want to give people the impression that we don't think our teachers are of high quality. Cultural competency cannot be treated as an add-on. It's not an extra, particularly when you look at the demographics in this district. We need teachers who are culturally competent. And when I say culturally competent, people sometimes think, okay, great, we have teachers who can write wonderful essays on cultural competency, or they took a class. That's not being culturally competent. Cultural competency has to be looked at as a journey. It's constantly ongoing. The mere fact, if you look at the changes of the demographics in Burlington in the last few years, with the refugees populations coming in with over 60 different languages, that means you have to look at it as a journey. You know, it's going to be constantly changing. Your populations are going to be constantly changing, your new American populations, new languages. You have to look at cultural competency as a journey. That means you're looking at teachers who have ongoing professional development and cultural competency. It's not a one-stop, one check the box, did a class, move on. One of the things I think is also real important is the whole issue of cultural inclusive curriculum aligned with state standards. When I think about my professional career and looking at cultural inclusive curriculum, I know the power and the benefits it can have. When you have children of very diverse backgrounds and they don't see themselves in the schools, they don't see themselves in the curriculum, it says to them, I don't belong, or where do I fit? That's one side of the coin. The other side of the coin is the fact that we're not exposing children who see themselves all the time in the textbooks and the curriculum to the rest of the world. So we have to move to having our curriculum totally culturally inclusive. Let's see. Equitable distribution of resources and opportunities and services for students. You know, education still is probably the most basic civil rights that everyone has. And we have to ensure that those opportunities and services and education achievement is there for all of our students. One of the things that I know that we need to look at, be very targeted on some of the classes that we have available, whether or not we're reaching out to students and making sure that they can see themselves as being in AP classes or honor classes. A lot of times, historically, children of diverse backgrounds, from coming from poverty, coming from populations of color, coming from second language backgrounds, are not approached or even encouraged to look at being in AP or honors courses. Let's see here. Another, I think, is a key point that we need to look at, and I was glad to hear Xander bring it up, was the piece of student voice. Most of our education systems, in our zeal to fix the problems, we forget to ask the kids. We forget to ask them what their experiences are. And if you really want to know what's going on, sit down and have a conversation with the kids. I'll share later, I'll give you some examples of some of the things that have come out. Family and community involvement. One of the things I think we really need to increase is that outreach to families and communities and bringing them to the table, as well as looking at what the issues are in the buildings. Another area that I think is real important that impacts the achievement gap is the whole piece of recruitment, hiring, and retention and cultural competency training. And I know at a later date, Nikki's going to do a full report on that. So some of our successes and results, and what I see is some of the proactive things. We recently did an updated diversity plan for 2014-17. One of the things when I came to the district that was impressive to me, I've been here a year and a half, was the Equity Council and the equity conversations that take place. In my 25 plus years in doing this work, I've always been the sole person responsible for doing the work. So to come to an organization where there's this dedicated team of two people from every school building who are on the Equity Council, who facilitate equity conversations on everything from dealing with poverty to dealing with our students who are LGBTQ, that kind of knowledge is something you sometimes will never have. And to have that internal piece is fantastic. I have to stress that the work of equity, diversity, and inclusion, and cultural competency and social justice cannot be successful without a team approach and district leadership that's going to hold everyone district-wide accountable. My office and the Office of Diversity and Equity can't do it alone. And frankly, I can tell you from my experience across the country, there's no one who can do it alone. It has to be a united team effort that includes all levels of the district, from the board, the superintendent, every teacher, and every staff member. Give you some update on student voice and leadership. One of the things I put on the table when I came here was knowing the unrest that had been at the high school. I asked the question what was being done there, and I said we need to see about establishing a Peace Jam International chapter there. And because of funding, our after-school program stepped up to the plate. And in fact, Christy is a Peace Jam coordinator herself. So she ordered the curriculum. We will be getting the Peace Jam International chapter started at the high school. And we're doing some outreach, because one of the things we learned that Winooski High School has had a Peace Jam chapter for years, and in fact just came back from an international conference. Recently, I believe it was in March, there was a student Kiva at the high school where students shared experiences as students of color and students from New Americans with teachers and staff. Very powerful opportunity for the students to share about who they were, as well as the staff to learn about the students. 2 months ago, we started a racism, it actually started out being a discussion on racism with Edmonds Middle School children, who wanted to have a conversation about the issues in their school, because they said their teachers wouldn't talk about it. This group expanded. It was initially going to be talking about racism, but they talk about everything from classism, sexual identity. We've had a few teachers drop in. Kyle's two sons are there on a regular basis. So that's a success when we start hearing the voices of kids, because kids will be very brutally honest about what their experiences are and what they're dealing with. We've added a qualitative component, which was one of the recommendations I made in last year's report, a qualitative component to the upcoming equity climate survey. And what that is going to involve is focus groups with students and staff and parents to get that additional qualitative insight as to what people's experiences are. Works in progress. We are in the process of working on a code of conduct, developing district-wide standards to be used by the entire district. I mentioned the climate survey revision and focus group. And just this afternoon, Nikki and I attended a meeting for reading on inclusion. And some of you are very familiar with reading for racism in the district. It's been going on for a number of years. We're now looking at doing an umbrella of calling Reading for Respect. Under that will fall Reading for Racism, Reading for Inclusion, and possibly two other categories. At that point, I'll stop, because that's a lot to do in 10 minutes, and see if you have any questions.
Thank you, Devin. We have about a minute for discussion, please.
Thank you for that. Appreciate that. I just want to point out that I know that from reading the whole report that one of the categories that you look at closely and that we do find disparity is in ability. And I know that's a fundamental part of your report, but it's missing from your first paragraph and in your first page.
Oh, okay.
And I would just ask that you go through and ensure that when you put the list of different populations that you do include ability in there.
Okay.
And also like to say that ability, just for people that aren't sure what exactly it is, it's not necessarily just intellectual ability, but can also be emotional health and emotional ability. So. To just make sure that's front and center, too. Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you. Anyone else? Thank you.
Susan had one.
Mark. Oh, I didn't see. I'm sorry.
Oh.
Please go ahead.
I was just wondering how you explore evaluating equity for lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgendered students. None of the data in the report directly addresses that for reasons I can well imagine, so I was just wondering how that
how you think about that. That is something we're working our way through in the revision of the climate survey that's going to come out in the fall. I believe it was Commissioner Chena who brought it up from looking at last year's climate survey. So we've added, which was a learning process for me as well. As I said, the cultural competency journey is one of a journey. We've added LGBTQ questions, which were staff, students, and parents can choose how they identify. There were a couple terms that were very new to me, such as asexual, pansexual. So people are going, that's one of the steps we're moving forward to gather that information, because and my coming here, one of the things as I did my research of coming to Burlington, I had colleagues say to me on the West Coast, there is a large LGBT community in the Burlington area. And recently, as I said, I've been dealing with an elementary child who is identifying as transgender, which is something the district has never had to deal with. So now we're going to be able to, in future reports, have that information by people self-identifying. And on the survey, it's anonymous, so people aren't feeling that they're going to be in a situation that they're letting out their personal information.
Thanks.
All right. Moving on to the...
Thank you, Devere.
Policy and Governance Report.
Thank you.
The Policy Governance Committee at its last meeting voted to recommend a revised policy B2, which is the board organizational policy, to the full board. The policy, as you can see on the agenda, creates a vice chair position in order to increase the capacity for the chair and the clerk to have a person to take on the duties of the chair when the chair is not able to perform their duties. The primary reason for this is because the clerk has a set of duties, and so the goal was to kind of distribute the labor of the leadership. So that being said, I'll make a motion to for the requesting that the board approve the revised policy.
A second. Isn't there more to that, or are you going to have additional motions?
That's the only motion being recommended from the committee.
You're now motioning for the waiver of the second reading and the adoption?
It doesn't have, why don't I just
whatever you want to do.
Take back, so Liz, since I made a motion and now we're having a discussion, I'm not sure how you want to handle this, but it seems inappropriate right now to have a discussion while the motion's on the floor. Would you like me to take my motion off the
table
and have a conversation?
Your motion hasn't been seconded yet, so we think
I seconded it.
Yes, it was.
Okay. Oh, it did second. Okay, I'm sorry. I didn't see it.
Okay, I'm confused.
So there's a motion and a second. Did you get the second?
No.
Did you get the motion?
I got the motion. Thank you.
I okay. seconded it. So do you want to discuss
Thank
now?
You.
Do you have a question?
I thought the motion was going to be to include the waiver of the second reading and the adoption.
So the policy on revising policies from the Department of Redundancy does not require a second reading. It would only go through a second reading if people wanted to, if there was a majority of board members that wanted to add or change this in any way, and then got referred back to the policy committee, then it would come back for a second reading.
Discussion?
I'd just like to clarify that the italics are in the current document for purposes of clarifying the new, and if the intention is the italics would be removed upon the formal approval, so the policy itself shouldn't have weird italics hanging around in it, but it's there for your convenience at the moment.
Any further discussion? All those in favor of the motion for the policy B2 as written, say aye.
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 All those against? Motion passes. Anything else on the policy and governance report?
The policy committee also discussed, as the superintendent indicated, because the policy committee is also the governance committee, we also discussed the superintendent's recommendations for the upcoming superintendent priorities for fiscal year 16. And yes, we also talked about a model for evaluating the superintendent, and Commissioner Judson is volunteered to research some models for that and bring them back to the committee.
Thank you. Any further discussion? Infrastructure and Technology Committee report.
All right. I put a quick note. I attached a quick note. If anybody wants to go through it more deeply, just ask me. But we discussed getting a facilities condition report done, such as the city just did, to better plan our long-range goals for the district. The second thing, Murray Street property did not sell, and we are either in the process of getting a realtor or we have. I'm not really sure where that landed over the last week. Paul, are we just in the process still of getting a realtor on that, Murray Street?
We're in the process.
Okay.
We've reached out to a number of realtors and a number of them have been to the property to take a look, and then they're just starting to get back to us with their thoughts, including what they think they could sell for, what their commission would be, that sort of thing.
Perfect. Horizon's on top. We got a timeline we're going to stick to. We're going to try and get this thing taken care of ASAP, and we have commercial realtors looking at that possibility as well for placement of that. Currently working, we're working on some safety concerns at BHS.
We had some parents in to speak about Champlain Schools, and Champlain Schools is penciled in for next year, tentatively, providing that Edmonds Middle Elementary doesn't require much more funding. Because we had to defer some work to next year because the work at Edmonds Middle and Edmonds Elementary exceeded the $2 million bond. So Champlain is on target right now as we stand, providing we don't have any complications at Edmonds. And that's basically it. And if you have any other questions, please ask. I added a note to the minute. That's not really the minutes. It's more easy to read. So if anybody has any questions, please look there or call me or whatever. Thanks.
Any questions for Commissioner Kurt? Thank you. Finance Committee report.
Okay. So I'm going to have one motion in a minute. That's the bulk of what I'll talk about. But I just encourage people to read the minutes. One of the things that we do at every finance meeting, which I think is very helpful, is we have what's called a master plan. And in the master plan are all the various things that the district is working on to ensure that we're in compliance with all the recommendations that were made at the end of last summer from our financial consultant and also from our auditor. And we go over that monthly, and it's a really user-friendly format. And you can see where we are on all of them. We're making good progress. The other thing we always do is we check in regarding where we are in terms of variances year-to-date and projected for the end of the year. And I was not here at the beginning of the meeting. Did you talk at all about that, Howard? Did that get mentioned? Or
the current year budget?
Yeah.
Yes, we went over that at the beginning.
Okay, good. So I don't need to say it again. So things are looking good. And then one of the things that we've been working on is a couple of financial policies. One of them is a fund balance policy, and the other is a conflict of interest policy. And these are things that Nate is working on and that we will be coming back to in the next month or two when they go through the policy committee and come back for us to vote on. The one other thing that I wanted to mention is just something that came up after our last meeting, which was that last year, for the first time, when we separated our cash from the city, we had to go out and get a line of credit, which is something that all school districts in the state do. It's a standard way of doing business, and now we do business that way too. However, we got a one-year line of credit, and we had to go out and bid again to get it a second time, so that is ongoing right now. Is that correct? And we should have some news by the next finance committee, and I wanted to make sure people were aware of that in case you hear about it from constituents. That's it. So may I have someone from the Finance Committee who might be willing to make the motion that is listed under our agenda item? Oh, and I need to explain what this is quickly. So David was just talking a minute ago about the fact that the district has decided that we need to move forward on planning, and the first step in planning is what David was talking about, which is more or less a study to get us going. I won't go over all the details of it, but if anyone is interested in them, you can look at them in the minutes from our meeting or from the minutes from the ITC meeting. But in order to go ahead and use funds to do this, we need, as a board, to approve those funds, because this was not an expense that was in our budget that was adopted by the public, and these are new revenues that we're using. We are suggesting that we use a small piece of the $700,000 BED unexpected rebate that we got. So we need board approval in order to use that money in order to start this, to do this study, to complete the study. So would someone like to make the motion?
I'd make that motion. We discussed it in the ITC and supported that motion.
So I'll just read it.
Does it have to be a person from the Finance Committee?
I don't think so.
Okay.
No. So it just says the motion to utilize surplus revenue contract with EMG for the purpose of conducting a facility condition assessment at a cost of $76,599.54. I want a second.
Second.
I think it's a great thing. I'd recommend we vote for it. And it's important that we do vote for it, because I think that's not only according to our own policies, our own financial policies, what we have to do, but I think it's signaling to the public that we're going into this with our eyes wide open. This is an important piece for us to go forward, and we're willing to pay a little bit of money to do it.
Any further discussion necessary? All those in favor of the motion as stated, please say aye.
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 All those against? Motion is passed. Thank you.
Can I ask a question about finance just quick? When is our next Finance Committee meeting, just for people to know?
It's the fourth Tuesday, and is it 7? I don't know that we ever settled on a time. It's usually at 7, but if it's not at 7, look at that.
It was 7:30 last time.
Last time, but wasn't that an unusual?
It was an anomaly. So is it going to be 7 this time? All right.
Yes.
Thank you.
Just 1 second.
It's at 7 o'clock.
Thank you.
26th. Do we need one motion or two motions for executive session?
Thank you for your patience. Next thing on the agenda is the executive session, in which case we have 3 points. We're going to discuss negotiations where premature disclosure could place the school district at a substantial disadvantage, where the finding that premature and general public knowledge of the specific facts of this personal matter would clearly place the board and the person involved at a substantial disadvantage, bearing on a contract, probable litigation which the board would be a party to, and confidential attorney-client communications made for the purpose of providing professional legal services to the board. And based on the prior specific finding for the purpose of discussing a personal matter, we'll now enter into executive session.
We can go in for three things at once?
No, he said we didn't.
What?
You need to, that is a proposed motion. Somebody needs
okay.
to take it as a motion.
We can do three at one in
yeah.
one?
Yeah, that's okay. Why I want
to
put
it. I would like to make a motion.
Seconded?
Or I would like to second the motion. Whatever the case may be.
Yeah, I would do the first, you're the second.
Okay, I'm the second because he read it.
All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Against? We will move.
So for this record, you're the first and I'm the second, right? Just so Elizabeth gets that. Okay. Do we go to another room now?
We're going to go down to the
planning,
meeting.
Planning, yeah.